गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
ओके, गुड मॉर्निंग। सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद अ न्यू हिस्ट्री चैप्टर, द नेशनल मूवमेंट। ओपन योर बुक्स टू दिस चैप्टर, द नेशनल मूवमेंट। ऑल राइट, सो दिस चैप्टर कवर्स the time period from 1870 to 1947. All right, now by this time you know the Indians had been under the control of the Britishers for more than 100 years, and you know, while we were doing the revolt of 1857, the rebellion of 1857, we have already seen that even by that time, 1857, all sections of Indian society, they were unhappy, dissatisfied, discontented with the rule of the Britishers. And so you know, by that time also people, they started to think against the British rule here in India. And so now 1870 and onwards, you know, by this time this feeling of dissatisfaction and discontent and anger, it started to grow in the hearts and the minds of people more. And they now came to realize that Indians will not be able to use their own resources, and the vast resources of a country would not be used for the progress and the good morning the progress and the promotion and the welfare of the citizens till the time the Britishers are ruling over us. Okay, so they thought that till the time they are ruling, we won't be able to use our resources for us. So the only way is that we oust the Britishers from India. And so this growing awareness among the people, it led to the formation of many political associations after 1850. And the main ones, the prominent ones that came into being in the 1870s were the Pune Sarvajanik Sabha, the Madras Mahajan Association, the Bombay Presidency Association, and the Indian National Congress. So these were the few major political associations that came into being in the 1870s. Now during the 1870s, young leaders in Bombay, they joined the Pune Sarvajanik Sabha, which was founded by Mahadev Govind Ranade. And now many of these associations, they started to work in different regions of India. And now, but their goal were one. And so these associations, they were established in different parts of the country, but basically they had one goal, and their one goal was that they would have a sovereign India. A sovereign India, does anyone know the meaning of sovereign here? Yes, do you have any idea what does sovereign mean? If you don't know, you could say no ma'am. Yes, Vaheb, Yashmet, any idea?
Mom, superiority, I think, monarchy, etc.
They wanted India to be sovereign. They were under the control of the Britishers and they wanted India to be sovereign. What does that mean? Now, sovereign basically means that you are free to rule yourselves as you wish within your own boundary, with no external rule over you. Alright, so like now India is a sovereign country and we are not under the control of any country. We can take our internal and external decisions as we want without the pressure, alright, or being under the dominance of any other country. So what they wanted, these political associations, they wanted India to be sovereign, and this was an important feature of nationalism or love for the nation. And now in 1870s and 1880s, already the dissatisfaction in the Indian society was there, and this dissatisfaction, it intensified, it grew more. Why? Because in 1878 we have the Arms Act, and this Arms Act was passed, and you know, according to this act, the Indians, they cannot possess weapons, and so they were not able to possess weapons, even licensed ones. And this act was passed by Lord Lytton. And so though the Indians, they were restricted from owning weapons and arms, but there were no such restrictions on the Britishers, and that is why the people, they became angry. And the nationalists, by this time, they had started to use the press, because now we all already had the printing press here, and they started to use press to arouse national consciousness among the people. And so you know, in the newspapers and the journals that they brought out, they wrote about the discriminatory policies of the Britishers and the way they were treating India, and that they only wanted to fill their own pockets, and the way the people were exploited and all that. So they started to write about that, and they started to criticize the policies of the Britishers, and this turned the British officials against the nationalists, against the Indian press, and they decided to curb the freedom. So at that time there was freedom of the press, and when the Indian press, it started to publish all these articles, so the British officials, they became angry, and they decided that they will curb the freedom, and they will put certain restrictions on the freedom of the press. And this, and in the same year, so 1878, we had one more act being passed, and that was the Vernacular Press Act. And this act put many restrictions on the press, and so according to this act, the Britishers, they were able to censor anything that was published in the newspapers. And so if they found anything objectionable, and so anything which you know, which could instigate violence among the people or hatred against the Britishers, so you know what they did, they confiscated the papers. They started to confiscate the newspapers and seize their machines and everything, their printing presses and all that. And so you know what happened, that the Indian presses, they wrote against the Britishers, and so they also did not like it, and so that is why they passed this act. But this act curbed the freedom of the press here in India, and so this was not liked by the Indians here at all. And now they will see a few other dissatisfaction and how the dissatisfaction grew among the Indians. Now earlier, the Indian magistrates, they could not try cases involving Europeans. So you know, Indians were tried in separate courts, and the Europeans, they were tried in separate courts. And so Lord Ripon and C.P. Ilbert, they wanted to put an end to this practice, because they thought that this was not right. And therefore in 1883, Ilbert, he introduced a bill according to which the Indian magistrate, they could also judge cases involving the Europeans. And as soon as the bill was out, the Europeans living in India, they started to protest against the bill. And means the protest, they grew so much that finally Lord Ripon, he was forced to yield to their demands and pull the bill back. And now according to the new rule, Europeans, they were tried in the district magistrate's court, and they could ask for a jury, and this jury comprised half of Europeans also. And so the Ilbert bill, it could not be passed, but it made the Indians realize that the Britishers, they did not treat Indians equally, and they realized the racial attitudes of the Britishers. And so what we could say is that this bill, it fanned into flame the feelings of patriotism and nationalism amongst the Indians. And so dissatisfaction growing and all that, and now the time was ripe for the formation of an All India political organization, and which and this organization should fulfill the need to unite all the people or the organizations politically against their common enemy, the Britishers. And because you know, we had political organizations earlier also. We had a look at some of the political organizations which were established and founded in 1870s, but like I told you, they were regional in their effect and in their policies also basically. But now the need was felt to have an all India political organization, and so with that in mind, the Indian National Congress, it was founded in 1885, and so it had the objective of having a greater share in government for educated Indians. And so because the number of Indians in the legislative council and assemblies and in the government bodies, they were, it was very less, and so this Indian National Congress was established so that they could have, they could put force, put pressure on the British government to have more Indians inducted in the governing bodies. Okay. And so initially the Indian National Congress, it was formed and it was not opposed to the British rule. And during its earlier years, the Congress, they met once during a year, and during December. And now, though it was Alan Octavian Hume, A.O. Hume, who brought about the first meeting of the Indian National Congress in Bombay, and this he did with the approval of Lord Dufferin, and the then Viceroy. So Lord Dufferin, he was then Viceroy, and in consultation with him only, with his approval only, the Indian National Congress, it was founded by Alan Octavian Hume. And then the first session of INC was held from 28th to 31st December 1885, and it was attended by 72 delegates. And W.C. Bonnerjee, he was the first president of the Indian National Congress. And some of the prominent leaders of the Congress during its early years were Dadabhai Naroji, Badruddin Tyabi, Firoz Shah Mehta, Surendranath Banerjee, Ramesh Chandra Dutt, Anand Mohan Bose, and Gopal Krishna Gokhale. So these were some of the prominent leaders of the Congress during its early years. Now, from its birth, like in 1885, the Indian National Congress, it was led by a group of people who were called as moderates. Okay, what do you understand by the term moderate?
Neither too much nor too less.
All right. So, like somewhere in the middle, you could say, neither very much or too less. And so these moderates, they were a class of elite, means they belong to the higher section of the society, and erudite men, means these men had great knowledge and learning. And now Dadabhai Naroji was one of the most prominent among these leaders. So he was the most prominent among the moderate leaders. And why these people were called moderates, let's have a look. Because the moderates did not want independence from the British rule. Okay, so the objective of the like we just now saw, that the Indian National Congress, it was not opposed to the British rule in its early years. So that is what it means they did not want independence from the British rule, but the main objective was to get certain things from the Britishers, like secure more representation for the Indians in the government and in the legislative council and assemblies. So basically, during the early years, they wanted certain things to be done for the Indians, like first, that they wanted that there should be more number of Indians in the legislative council or in the government bodies. Then the moderate wanted Indians in the Indian civil service. And you know, the problem was that the age limit for the civil services at that time was very low, and the Indians, they started their education later on, not as early as we have now. And so, you know, by the time they were eligible for the civil service examinations, they were overage. So that was one reason that why they were not able to opt for the Indian civil service examinations, and then you know these civil service examinations, they were held at that time only in London. And so if anyone wanted to give, you know, he had to go from India to England just to give the examination. And you know, that was not possible for all the people here. Everyone could not afford to do that. And so the moderate wanted more Indians. They wanted the Britishers to lower the age so that more Indians, they could sit for this exam, so that more Indians could find a place in the administration here. Then they wanted the reduction of government expenditure and taxes, and including the salt tax. They wanted reduction in the government expenditure. Now a lot was spent on on the army and all that, because the Britishers, they wanted to expand their territories here, and they sent Indians to other places also to fight their battles and all that. And so the people here, they wanted the government to reduce their expenditure so that more money could be spent on the welfare of the people. And they wanted reduction of the taxes, including salt tax. Now this Gandhiji later on, he said that the salt tax showed the most oppressive face of the Britishers, because something as common as salt also was being taxed. And you know, the Britishers at that time, they had monopoly over the production and the sale of salt. And it was not only that they had put tax on it, but only the Britishers, they can produce and they could sell salt. As you know, in the coastal areas, there was a very easy means of livelihood for the people there, but they were deprived of it. And we will see more of it later in the chapter. Okay, then from 1885 to 1892, the moderates, they demanded the expansion and reforms in the legislative councils. And the British government, they were forced to pass the Indian Councils Act of 1892. And by this act, the number of Indians in the Imperial Legislative Council as well as the provincial councils, they were increased. But the nationalists, they were dissatisfied with the Council Act of 1892. Why? Because only the number of Indians were increased a little, but their powers did not increase in the same measure. So the moderates, they demanded a larger share for the Indians in the councils, but they also wanted wider powers for them, which was not given. And so the early nationalists, one more demand of them were that they desired the Indianization of the higher grades of administrative service. They wanted that Indians should be employed in the administration in the higher positions also, because economically also the European monopoly of higher services was harmful on two grounds. Because you know, at the higher positions, they are Britishers, they employed only the Europeans, and now this was harmful on the not only on the social aspect but also on economic aspect. Why? Because you know, the Europeans, they were paid high salaries, whereas Indians with the same qualifications, they were paid lower salaries. And now this made the administration, Indian administration, very costly. And obviously, you know, from where would you pay? Obviously the taxes which were levied on the people. Then the Europeans, you know, they were working here, but their families were there back in England, in Britain. And so the Europeans, they sent out of India a large part of their salaries, and their pensions were also paid in England. And so this added to the drain of wealth from India to England. So the money was not staying in Indian market, it was going from India to England. And so the nationalists, they demanded the separation of judiciary from the executive powers, and so that they wanted that judiciary should be separate from the executive, from the ruling government. And why? Because the people, they should get protection from the arbitrary acts of the police and their bureaucracy. Means because you know, the judiciary also was connected with the executive, and so they could not give a free and fair verdict. And the people, the police and the bureaucracy also, they were working on their whims and not following a particular system. And so that is what is meant by arbitrary acts. Means they were not following a proper system, but they worked on their wishes more. and they wanted this to come to an end. And so they laid a great deal of emphasis on the spread of, and they also laid a great deal of emphasis on the spread of primary education among the masses. All right, I think we should stop here. Have you understood what we did today? Any confusion, anyone?
No, ma'am.
Yes, the rest of you? Is everything
no,
clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so we will continue with the chapter when we meet again. And today itself, I will send you the PDF of the question answers of the last civics chapter. All right?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.